Now I will demonstrate some neurological signs. Exaggerated jerks. We have already seen delayed relaxation of tendon jerk in myxedema. See it again. See the slow relaxation phase. Now compare it with a brisk and exaggerated tendon jerk. This is typical in upper motor neuron type of paralysis. Watch the exaggerated ankle jerk. Exaggerated ankle jerk may also be demonstrated through ankle clonus. Sustained dorsiflexion of the foot results in ankle clonus, that is a repetitive rhythmic contraction of the calf muscles, recurring for as long as the pressure is maintained on the sole of the foot. Upper motor neuron lesions also show extensor plantars, that is positive Babinski reflex. It is demonstrated by stimulation of the sole along the lateral border from the heel towards the toes. This normally causes plantar flexion of the soles, but as you can see here, there is dorsiflexion of the toes, that is a positive Babinski reflex. It can also be demonstrated by firm pressure along the anteromedian surface of the upper tibia, termed as Oppenheim's sign. And it can also be demonstrated by squeezing the Achilles tendon, termed as Schauffer's sign. Radial palsy. Note the wrist drop on the left side due to radial nerve palsy. The fingers can be extended because the introtia are supplied by the ulnar nerve. But the wrist, the thumb, and the metacarpophalangeal joints of the fingers cannot be extended. Now watch the brachioradialis muscle in the normal right hand as it stands out when a mid-prone forearm is flexed against resistance. But on the affected side, it does not contract and remains soft. Now here I have marked the area of anesthesia, which is characteristic of radial nerve palsy. Note that within this area, the patient does not feel the pinprick, but outside it, the sensations are normal. Now this is a ulnar claw hand deformity, affecting mainly the little and ring finger. Due to flexion of interphalangeal joints with extension of metacarpophalangeal joints following ulnar nerve injury. Note the wasting of hypothenar and thenar eminences. Now compare it with a classical claw hand, which occurs in ulnar and median nerve injury, brachial plexus injuries, leprosy, cervical rib, and spinal cord lesions like syringomyelia. Now we shall see a few involuntary movements. When a young child comes with irregular, senseless movements, he is not affected by any ghost. He is affected by rheumatic fever and is having rheumatic chorea. If the patient is adult, then of course it is unlikely to be rheumatic. Then you should think of other causes, especially hysteria. Watch the boy as he is trying hard to hold his hands steady, but he cannot. The chorea is involuntary and he cannot control it. It usually persists even after treatment for 3 to 6 months. Everyone must have seen senile tremors. They mainly affect the hands and the neck. There is no definite treatment for senile tremors. B complex and tranquilizers may show temporary benefits, but these tremors have to be accepted. If the tremors are more on one side of the body or are accompanied by rigidity and mask-like face, then think of Parkinsonism. Watch the mask-like face without any expressions. There is hardly any movement of the facial muscles when the patient is talking. Only the jaw is moving. This is a mask-like face of Parkinsonism. Watch the tremors of the hand. Watch the imbalanced gait. And watch the typical pin rolling tremors of Parkinsonism.